Good afternoon. It's really a pleasure to me for me to be here. Not only the weather is much better from where I come, but this is, it's such a treat to sit in a meeting and look at what people do and go, oh my God, people really do that? It's so refreshing and so thrilling to just sit here, and I laud you for having that kind of meeting. It's really an experience, one of a kind, and I really want to be part of it as you go forward. So I'm very grateful to be here and part of this group, and what I want to talk to you about, modeling in medicine. So I particularly will talk about the heart today. And as you know, we heard that today computer simulations have been used to build civic structures, airplanes, automobiles. What I want to do, and I want to usher this, is to bring computational heart modeling within contemporary patient care. I do believe personally that computational modeling can bring a slew of approaches to personalized health, and we are at the threshold of a new era where we can bring all what we have learned from engineering and apply it to medicine. Computational heart modeling, what do I mean by that? So what we want to do is, the way we want to bring this in contemporary patient care is, we would want to have a patient-specific simulation environment. What I mean by that is, we would like to be able to take scans from the patient of their heart, whether that's MRI or CT scans, and use these scans to build a model, and we want this model to be really predictive and incorporate information from the molecular level to the entire heart, a true multi-scale model, and then apply that to the diagnosis and treatment of heart rhythm disorder as well as pump disorders. But I want to talk today about heart rhythm disorder specifically in patients with structural disease. So this is our big mission. And I'll spend majority of my talk talking about what we call virtual electrophysiology lab. So what would be the impact of doing that? First of all, we expect that doing that will reduce invasiveness of a lot of diagnostic procedures, will substantially improve therapies, and will dramatically reduce costs. And my goal here is to convince you of that. So here is what we mean by computational modeling of the heart. In my lab, for over 20 years, we have been developing this very sophisticated model of the heart that incorporate information, as I said, from the molecular level all the way to the organ. And our modeling environment consists of two components. One describes the electrical properties of the heart, and another describes the mechanical. They are coupled on the molecular level. We can incorporate information about the numerous of ionic processes, molecular processes, cellular, subcellular processes. So in a way, we view our heart models as like a Google heart. You can look at a behavior on the whole heart, but also you can zoom in and look at the behavior at the molecular level. And the infrastructure is such, it's built in such a way that new information as it arrives for the dynamics of molecular processes or signaling can be incorporated within the whole infrastructure. Today, I will be predominantly talking about the electrical modeling, and that's why it's entitled Virtual Electrophysiology Lab. So that's the general approach. Now, what I want to do is go through numerous, actually five, clinical applications that we have started, and this is a it's a collaborative effort, of course, with a lot of physicians at Johns Hopkins. And I will want to tell you a priori that this is it's something that has stunned a lot of people. Nobody believes that one can do computational modeling that can be used directly in patient care to predict the behavior of the heart. So again, we are making the initial steps in that direction. So my first application is predicting the optimal targets of ablation of infarct-related ventricular tachycardia. It's a long title. What does this mean? Okay, so when a patient has an infarction, very often they develop a rhythm disorder. Rhythm disorder, arrhythmia. Arrhythmia is actually, in the heart, constitutes of a recirculating wave. You can think of that as a hurricane or tornado on the heart. And it recirculates instead of going through the heart, and then the heart relaxes and is able to contract, and then a new wave comes. So the electrical wave in the heart is the trigger of the mechanical contraction. So if an electrical wave does not propagate through the heart, and then there is a silent period, you can see that the heart is trying to contract all the time. So because of that, it cannot efficiently pump blood. So this is a very, this is a little disorder. In a human, 5 to 7 minutes, and you know, death ensues, and that's why they use pedals to restore heart rhythm. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to take patient information and predict what is the arrhythmia in this patient. And after that, we want to use this information to predict what is the best treatment for this arrhythmia. Now, what do they do clinically right now? When a patient has an infarction and develops an arrhythmia, that may not be persistent, but comes and goes, typically this patient is evaluated for what is called catheter ablation. Okay, the way this is done is the patient is referred for ablation, it comes in, and the physician actually uses a fluoroscope, it's like an X-ray machine, and navigates a catheter within the patient's heart, and then probes around the heart, giving small electrical stimuli to elicit an arrhythmia. If it is possible to do so, this patient is a candidate for ablation. Ablation is the burning of a piece of tissue that sustains this recirculating wave. So the physician sees, navigates the catheter, stimulates, and then based on the information from this catheter, what is built is called a map of the potentials in this patient heart. And based on that very crude information, the physician decides where to burn. This is the actual heart that has been burnt in one of these processes. The procedure lasts 4 to 12 hours. It has only 51% success rate. You can see how many burns have been made in this patient's heart. And the reason that is the case is because they basically do not know where to burn, what part of the tissue should be burned to terminate the arrhythmia. So basically, they are bombarding the heart with these burns. And as a result of that, the functioning of the heart is diminished. Also, this very long procedure has a lot of complications, can lead to the perforation of the heart, and so forth. So here we come with a radically different approach. We propose to use the pre-ablation MRI scan of the patient, and then take this pre-ablation MRI scan, do image processing on it, determine where is the infarct, because the infarct is a very important structural substrate that underlies the arrhythmia. Reconstruct the infarct. We also reconstruct what's called a peri-infarct, that zone that is not dead, because the one that's really dead in the middle, it's just dead tissue. But the one that's around is the sick tissue that sustains the arrhythmia. So we reconstruct all that, make a model of the heart that incorporates this structural remodeling, and then we predict where would be the organizing center of this arrhythmia, and that's where we should, the physician should burn. The advantage of this approach is that there is a non-invasive identification of these targets. Then the physician can very swiftly navigate the catheter to the predicted region and conduct an ablation. The lesions are much smaller. They don't have to bombard the whole heart with burns. In addition to that, there will be improved tolerance to the therapy because it is going to last much shorter time and, of course, reduced complications. So how do we go about building a model of a patient heart? So here is a patient MRI scan, as you can see. And what we are doing after that is we are segmenting the 2D slices, and then we are reconstructing the whole heart using some novel image processing methodologies. We also reconstruct the actual infarct, not just the infarct itself, but also the peri-infarct or border zone that I talked about. We do that, and then we combine these two to get a image of the heart, a model of the heart that incorporates geometry, the infarct, and the peri-infarct semi-viable zone. We construct that model, and then what is very important for the heart, actually, the actual heart has fiber orientation, which is very important for the functioning of the heart. The fiber orientation allows the heart to squeeze properly. You can think when you have a laundry, the best way to do is to wring, and the fibers in the heart actually follow these spiraling pathways, generally. But in each individual patient, they are somewhat different. Turns out that these fibers are also very important for the electrical propagation of the impulse in the heart, so they need to be reconstructed. So we struggled with this for a very long time because you cannot get from MRI images what is the distribution of the fibers in the heart. So we developed our own methodology for estimating that. What we do is we use an atlas of a patient heart, Atlas heart with a high resolution that we know the fibers, and then we have a patient heart and we morph the two, and in the morphing process, the matrix carries the information about the fiber orientations. Anyways, so we use this methodology to estimate the fiber orientation in the patient heart. So we have geometry, infarct, fiber orientation. And so, and then we can actually predict where, what is the arrhythmia and show where to ablate to achieve successful termination of the arrhythmia. Now, how do we validate that? So I want to show you very briefly results of enigmatic experiments with which we validated that. So in this case, a collaborator of mine, Dr. Halperin at Hopkins, did pig experiments in which they infarcted the pigs, and then we reconstructed, and then they ablated the pigs, they had arrhythmias, and they ablated the pigs. They were not always successful. Okay, so what we did is, the first thing we did is, we reconstructed one of their successful experiments. So here is the pre-ablation MRI scan. We did the model generation. You can see the model incorporates the infarct, the peri-infarct zone, and then we did an arrhythmia simulation. This is showing the endocardial inner surface of the heart. You can see the hurricane-like organizing center. This is the arrhythmia. What they did in the experiment, you can see here on the CT scan, these dots represent the tip of the catheter that burned the tissue. Not the actual burn, the tip of the catheter. So they did numerous burns. We reconstructed these burns in the model. You can see them here modeled within the model of that pig heart. Here they are. And then we use that to demonstrate that if we put these burns in our model, we also will terminate the arrhythmia, as the experiment did. And then here is, you can see it immediately terminates. So what's happening here is the simulation correctly predicted the successful ablation. However, the benefit of our simulation is that we can so accurately predict, and you see it immediately terminate, with a much smaller lesion. So not only that our simulation predicted what was done in the experiment, but our optimal ablation target was much, much smaller. You can see what kind of benefit that would be for the patient. Then let me show you a failed ablation. In this pig, they couldn't terminate the arrhythmia. That's where they had the burns, the tip of the catheter. We reconstructed the model, and we put in these ablation lesions. And you can see when we simulate it, as you can see, the arrhythmia did not terminate. So our simulation also predicted failure of the ablation correctly. So, but we are able to say, ha, you should have gone and ablated in another place, and we could have predicted where, and we indeed did that, and you can see our prediction was here, and if you indeed do that, then in this case, arrhythmia, there is only one beat, and then it terminates. So that was the optimal ablation site in this case. So the simulation predicted that. And then so those were animal experiments. I just give you a snippets of that. And then we went forward and did a human study. So these are 12 patients shown here, actual patients that were cured of that at Hopkins. And what we did is we took their pre-ablation MRI scans, reconstructed the infarcts and the peri-infarct zones, And then we did simulations with those to predict what are the arrhythmias and where successful ablation would be. And as I said, these patients have been ablated successfully. So we have our prediction and we compare it to what was done in the clinic. And so here is the first three patients. So you can see here, this is our model, you can see the arrhythmia, okay? So there is kind of organizing center in this area, all right? And this is, hopefully you can see here, this is within the blue line is the whole, is the burnt area. In all these cases, the blue line contains the areas which were burned. And you can see our predictions are in the red. So our predictions are always within what was successfully ablated, but not only that, they were always much smaller, as you can see here, only one small point. We looked at the predicted clinic, we compared even the clinical ECGs with the simulated ECGs. I want to show you another movie here. This is the second heart right here. You can see where is the organizing center. And another movie. This one was a complex arrhythmia, very complex. It was in the septum, the organizing center, very hard to reach. So they kind of straddled the electrode, the burning catheter, up and down the heart to reach that. And you can see our prediction is much, much smaller. So this was a pretty successful retrospective study, and now we are working with to do prospective when we can predict where to ablate and just provide this information to the physician and then see whether that works. Okay, so this was one of our projects under this big umbrella of what we call virtual electrophysiology lab. The second is arrhythmia risk stratification in patients with myocardial infarction. What does this mean? Okay, so currently, when a patient develops an infarct, the first thing happens is the patient is evaluated in order to see whether he or she needs an implantable defibrillator. Currently, there is one criterion that is used for that. This is left ventricular ejection fraction less than 35%. How much blood is ejected by the heart? If it is below 35%, they get defibrillators. That's it. However, this criterion is very non-specific. As a result of that, in each single year, only 5% of the patients receive appropriate device therapy. The other patients are subjected to risks of infection, component malfunction, inappropriate shocks, without receiving benefit of having the device. Most importantly, though, this criterion misses many at-risk patients who would have, let's say, 40% or somewhere there ejection fraction. As a matter of fact, turns out that this group of people constitutes the largest amount of group of people that will die of sudden cardiac death. So what we are trying to do is to better stratify patients for arrhythmia risk. Now, it has been shown that if they can undergo the very extensive electrophysiological evaluation that I showed you before, risk can be predicted, but nobody would do that because it is so, it is dangerous and very expensive and has a very high probability of complications. So again, we propose to do, as before, take the patient MRI, pre-device implantation, construct the heart, predict where the arrhythmia is. In this case, we do not have to predict where is the organizing center of arrhythmia. All what we need to do is to say, will the patient develop an arrhythmia or not? So in a way, it's kind of simpler application. Again, the advantage is huge because it's economical. It will be accurate stratification. The most important benefit is decreasing the number of sudden cardiac deaths because some people are not receiving defibrillators. Eliminate the unnecessary ICD implantation and the likelihood of inappropriate shocks and associated side effects. So what we have done this far is a retrospective feasibility. We went straight to human studies. We are using a cohort of 165 patients. We've processed, I'm showing here, 40. Right now we have 60-something that we have processed. You can see you have the infarct and the border zone reconstructed. And what we are doing is for each of these patients, we are simulating an arrhythmias that can originate from a lot of different locations, and we are able to say whether they will develop an arrhythmia or not. So what I'm showing here in the top row are five hearts in which no matter how you probe them, they do not develop an arrhythmia. And in the lower group, when you probe them at here and there on a location, they develop arrhythmias, and you can see the recirculating wave. So we have had pretty good success. This criterion predicts arrhythmia in about 5% of the cases. We predict in about 69% of the cases. We are hoping that we can achieve even higher degree of success when you have consecutive MRI scans, because the infarct morphology might change, so we might be able to incorporate that information over time. So that's our second study. I want to now talk about the third clinical application study that we are doing. This is predicting the optimal targets of ablation, again burning, but this is for persistent atrial fibrillation in patients with fibrotic scar. Now, atrial fibrillation is the most dominant arrhythmia in humans. Period. As we age, as the population ages, the incidence of atrial fibrillation increases dramatically. This is not a little arrhythmia. However, it leads to stroke and also causes, ultimately, ventricular problems as well as heart failure. So it's a huge burden. It is the largest, in terms of cardiovascular diseases, this is the largest burden to society. So what we are trying to do, and the ablating patients with atrial fibrillation that have fibrotic scar is the most difficult. So fibrotic scar is the growth of fibrosis, like connective tissue within the atria. Now, I just wanted to show you, for those that don't know, those were the ventricles that I have been talking about. The atria are these two upper chambers. So that's what we will be talking. Now, what is done currently in the clinic? Very similar to what is done in the ventricles. A catheter is navigated, and they just burn around. And here is a patient for whom atrial fibrillation has been attempted to be terminated. You can see how many burns have been made. So our approach is, again, to reconstruct the atria of the patient and then do modeling with this and predict where to ablate. Now, unfortunately, and these are the advantages of our approach, again, similar to what we do for ventricular applications. Now, unfortunately, the atria are very, very thin, so the image processing involved in that is much more difficult than for the ventricles. This is what's called delayed enhancement MRI scan. You can see it here, which shows the fibrotic regions, and we are able to reconstruct that. This is our pipeline for reconstruction, and you can see here all the fibrotic lesions in this patient, and we are also able to use our approach to reconstruct the fiber orientation in the patient atria. So we are able to reconstruct that, and now we have a very sophisticated model that incorporates all the information about what happens under the conditions of fibrosis. Turns out it isn't just that there is collagen that grows in these fibrotic atria, but also fibroblasts, which are actually cells that secrete the collagen, they undergo a phenotypic change into a myofibroblast. They become very active, and also they can do all kinds of electrical effects. So we incorporate that in our model. So our model is very, very sophisticated. It represents not only the myocytes, but the fibroblasts, and via the paracrine interactions and electrical coupling in these hearts. So it's a true, from the molecular to the whole organ model. So you can see here four patient-specific models that have different amount of fibrosis in them. They were provided to us by the University of Utah. This is their scan of the patients. So we use these patients. I forgot to tell you, by the way, for all the applications, whenever we predict anything, we are blind to the clinical outcomes. We do not know whether these patients developed, and only when we complete the study, we compare. And also, it's in this case as well. We didn't know what kind of arrhythmias or whether they developed an arrhythmia or not. All what we are provided is the scans. And from here on, we go ahead, predict what kind of arrhythmia they have and where to ablate to successfully terminate the arrhythmia. So here is one patient heart. You can see this one has a lot of fibrotic tissue, and I'm showing three locations from which, if you probe, you can elicit an arrhythmia. You can see here the arrhythmia, and from another location would be this one. So they're differently looking. From a third location would be this one. So our model says this patient must have an arrhythmia, pretty serious. And indeed, when we finished the study, they told us in the patient history that the patient had persistent atrial fibrillation. Then we went ahead and predicted where they should burn to terminate the arrhythmia. And this movie shows that you, if you do these three ablation lesions in these locations, it terminates the arrhythmia. Here is another patient example. And this one was not as irritable, if you will. You can see from two locations we elicited, still developed an arrhythmia. Turns out, indeed, the patient had an arrhythmia. And then we predicted where to ablate. And those are two locations. And here, just a couple movies. This is new data. We got this data from France, from a group in Bordeaux that does a lot of patients ablation in patients with atrial fibrillation. Another movie showing arrhythmia in these patients. So it, we have sets of data that we are now processing. So this was the application on atrial fibrillation. So now I want to move to the fourth application under this big umbrella of clinical applications, which is predicting the optimal defibrillation configuration in patients with congenital heart disease. What does this mean? Now, children and patients with congenital heart disease, there is absolutely no standard approach where to implant the device. We know in a standard, you know, in an adult patient, you place the can in the pectoral cavity and a catheter goes on the right side of the heart, and that's how the defibrillation shock occurs between these two electrodes. Now, when you have a baby and the device is, the can is that big, where are you going to implant that? If you have a heart that's malformed, where are you going to put the catheter? So there is completely no standard clinical approach for these patients at all. And there is no reliable methodologies to determine what would be the optimal placement. So we took upon us to use our predictive model. This time will be a model of the patient heart together with the torso, because the device is placed within the torso, to figure out where to place that. So that's our task under this application. So here is a child with tricuspid valve atresia. So you can see in this child, you cannot see the right ventricle. It basically doesn't exist. So it's only a left ventricle. It's undergone several operations to make the heart function somewhat. These patients all develop arrhythmias. We were able to reconstruct the heart of that patient, and then we are doing also, as I said, all of the organs within the torso. We have the lungs, ribs, skin, all that. So it's a very sophisticated model. And as I said, we retain the multiscale nature of our heart. So it has, from the molecular to the whole heart representations. This is an arrhythmia in this patient, and you can see the defibrillation shock. It's, you can see it, you recognize it, because it kind of synchronizes the activity of the heart in this patient. So it's still an arrhythmia. There it is. That was the electrical shock and terminates the arrhythmia. Okay? So, but where to place it? So we did a lot of simulations with this model. You can see here, we placed it in a lot of locations, and we were able to figure out which one results in the smallest amount of energy to be delivered to successfully terminate the arrhythmia in this patient, turned out to be this one. And so this is an application that we did with the Children's Hospital at Hopkins, got a lot of publicity, and I wanted to share that with you. So this is our virtual electrophysiology lab. So this is kind of the first part of my talk. We think this is a transformative approach that brings computational modeling of individual heart dysfunction to the clinic for guidance of therapies. And we believe that it represents a paradigm shift in cardiac patient care. And we were very thrilled to just have received 2 months ago the NIH Director's Pioneer Award for these efforts. So that's a five-year project with a very large budget. Anyway, so this is kind of the umbrella of projects that under the Virtual Electrophysiology Lab. What I want to do right now is I want to, how am I doing for time? I'm doing good. Okay, so what I want to share with you is something else that we're doing in my lab that some people think it's more out there even than what we're doing right now. So I want to share with you, this is along the therapy studies that are going into my lab. I want to focus on that, optogenetics. You might have heard that term. Optogenetics is a process of expressing photosensitive ion channels in tissue so that precise response can be elicited. This mouse has a laser pointer to its brain, and then it follows the laser pointer. Basically, the mouse brain has been made to express these photosensitive ionic channels that pass electrical signal when light is shined on the mouse's brain. This was an approach that was developed in Stanford, in Carl Deseroth's lab, and has been applied now. There are a lot of studies in the brain for that. What we did is we decided to develop a comprehensive framework for cardiac optogenetic simulations. So there is very little done for the heart, but we thought that the role of computational modeling these days is not just to prove hypotheses, but also to be forward, ahead of the experimentation, and guide the experimentation. We wanted to do is to figure out which are the most important parameters to look at, how to configure the light, how to deliver the light to achieve the best application. So while the experiments are yet at the sort of a Petri level cell monolayers, we created a model of the whole heart to see how we can apply that. So this is how we did that. We have a cardiac simulation hierarchy at the organ level where we represent the illumination model of the light. We also have tissue level in which we represent the distribution of light sensitive cell. And at the cell level, we model the expression of these light sensitive proteins. This one is called channel rhodopsin. So this is a channel when light is shined, it opens and conducts electrical current. So the behavior of the cell can be controlled with light. So this is how we did that. At the cellular level, we use I'm not going to go through this, just to tell you that these are Markov processes that we incorporate how it goes from a dark state into a light state. Also at the tissue level, at the cell level, we also incorporate different modes of delivery of this light sensitive channel. You can directly express it in the cardiac cells, and then we have to model that. So one way is to do a viral transfection and have the channel directly expressed in the membrane of the cell. The other way is to express it in a small cell like a HEC or HeLa cell, and then implant that cell in the myocardium. And this is called the cell delivery approach. So these other cells, then in this case HEC cells, are coupled with the myocytes. So they are the donor cells of the light-sensitive channels. They couple with the myocytes. And so we incorporate this in the model at the cellular level. At the tissue level, we have to model the distribution of the light-sensitive channels. And this distribution is always non-uniform. So we've done stochastic algorithms to look at what is the density and the level of patchiness, and we can model from high to low and so forth, high to low density within these cells. And then this is our tissue level model. At the organ level, we are able to accurately model the optrode or other device that is going to be delivering the light. And here I just wanted to show you one application of this. In this case, we have four cases. This is gene delivery mode, and this is a cell delivery mode. But the distribution of cells is different in these cases. So we can actually calculate very important things, is like Which of these cases the light is sufficient to initiate an electrical signal? Depending on the distribution, what thresholds are better? So we can answer a lot of practical questions when we come to that. So for instance, in this case, we can calculate all the thresholds, and depending on if the delivery was gene delivery, then in this case, when you have consolidated distribution of the cells, in this case, the threshold was lower. Questions like that we can address. What else can we do with this methodology is we can, the heart has a conduction system. So what you see here are Purkinje fibers that carry the signal from the top of the heart to the bottom. And we can also express these cells only in the conduction system of the heart. So in this case, we can illuminate the inner side of the heart, but only these fibers get excited and they can deliver the propagation to the whole heart. Finally, what we can do is you can shine light and make the heart contract, which is very important to resynchronization of the heart in patients who do not have a pump failure. So this is another application that we can do with this. So overall, it is a very powerful tool for the design and optimization of novel therapies in cardiology, particularly optogenetics. So we wrote that paper and got published in August in Nature Communications. So what followed was a storm, a serious media frenzy, okay? So what ended up happening is we started getting all these phone calls, and people really, they were very interested in that. But the whole concept of this was so bizarre. Whenever they would interview me about the paper, they would ask me, so this is an amazing medical discovery. What is the biggest message that we can take from this? And I would say, the biggest message is computational models have gotten so sophisticated, we can apply them to medicine. Never made it into any interviews, any article. All what they wanted to talk is, I want to show you this. So this was an article written about our study in Slate. You can see we are squished between two Obamas here. This article talks about Star Wars, Arrested Development, Mortal Kombat, our research in this context. Never even mentions it's a simulation. We were on NPR, and all the time, every other sentence I would say, this is a computational modeling. This has gotten so sophisticated. We are so good at that. It's going to make a revolution. Never made it into the... It's all about if we turn the light on where the patient is, would the patient get an arrhythmia or get defibrillated? Things like that. So it was a very interesting experience. I don't think people were prepared to see an application of computational medicine getting that far and being used to predict. This is our local newspaper. It's one of those things that you don't know what is going to make the headlines. Anyway, so so we believe that creating platforms like this that go ahead of the clinical application, even ahead of the experiment in this case, can be really very, very important for driving the research. Instead of going and using trial and error approaches, we can actually have a concerted effort towards developing the best therapies in the fastest, in the smallest amount of time. So these are two examples from my lab. One big umbrella that has a lot of clinical approaches, one that's more basic science, also computational. We do a lot of other projects that are, I just wanted to give you a diagram of what we do. We have a lot of mechanistic insight. So we work on just the basic mechanisms of arrhythmia as well. A lot of the stuff is actually cellular-based. We work on redistribution of channels that happens at cellular organelles as well. We work on mitochondrial bioenergetics, mechanoelectric feedbacks. We have a lot of research now on how there is a collapse of the mitochondrial membrane and how that ultimately leads to cardiac disease. But in addition to that, as I said, we have a very big sort of a research in the therapies, and mostly I focused on that. But I just want to say, I don't want to forget to say that model building is a very big part of my lab as well. And it's a very diverse model building because we need not only solvers, those are systems of partial differential equations that couple to ordinary differential equations, describing the kinetics of these molecules and proteins. We have continuum mechanics. We have also a huge effort in image processing. Image processing is essential for us, for our clinical application. So a lot of that mesh generation, visualization, all that comes here. This is the background in what we do behind the scenes, but extremely important. To me, we have to always develop the models parallel with the applications, otherwise we will be forgotten soon. And so, I want to acknowledge support of my work, most importantly, the new NIH Director's Pioneer Award, but also my other R01 grants, and I also have NSF grant. We are actually trying to combine our electromechanical model with a fluid dynamics model. Hopefully we'll succeed in that. So this is the support that I need to acknowledge, and also acknowledge all the people that I work, a huge number of people at the School of Medicine, at Hopkins, with whom I collaborate, and also outside. And then finally, and the most importantly, my lab. My lab is the most devoted lab ever. They are just extremely hardworking people, very productive lab, and I'm just presenting. They do the work. Well, anyways, thank you very much. I'm happy to take any questions. Oh, I will get a question.
That was fascinating. I'm a vascular surgeon, so devices and imaging and how we can use the computational modeling for stent migration and to make it just much more elegant for how we take care of our patients. So you spent a lot of time on the heart. Have you been looking at abdominal aortic aneurysms and predicting ruptures, or how to better design these modular stents so that they don't have the complications of endograft leak and migration?
We have not done that. Our expertise is in the heart, but as part of that last grant that I told you that combines also the fluid dynamics, we are looking at thrombus formation, which is not exactly what you are saying. But in patients with heart failure, when the heart doesn't contract well enough, there is a lot of stagnant flow. And we've been looking at under what conditions. For instance, turns out it depends very much on where the infarct location is. That the formation of the thromb depends very much on that. So that's the stuff that we are looking, and we are hoping that another project that is related to that is basically trying to do diagnosis. We have linked the fluid dynamics model, my collaborator, with also acoustics model, and we are trying to figure out for patients who have diastolic or systolic heart failure whether we can do some diagnosis just by sound, for instance. These are like early projects. We haven't gotten to stents, so I don't know whether in my lifetime I would be able to do that, but there are people who are doing that that I would like to work with, because these things can be very well linked and build a whole sort of a holistic model of the whole pathophysiology. Thank you.
Have you looked at doing any model reduction techniques for portable patient monitoring and matching up monitoring results with reduced order models?
We have not done that. And so what the specialty of my lab is that these multi-scale models. There is a lot of modeling involved in the process. For instance, if you have a device, there are models that will tell you whether the device, let's say the catheter, will break or not. Or there are models of clinical trials. So what you're saying, there is a broad field in that. My lab specializes in these multi-scale, what we call a biophysically detailed model. So we want to know what's happening at the molecular level and how interactions at the molecular level lead to an emergent property. A hugely nonlinear system. You cannot predict what's happening from these interactions, what will be at the whole organ. So that's the answer to your question.